Hello and welcome to Factorio. In this series, we will build a MIPS computer with, well, a couple of combinators. We have Nixtitubes, which is a mod that allows you to display numbers. For example, oh, I don't have power over here. Numbers and letters. So it's displaying the B signal here, and here's just displaying the letter. We have the push button mod, which allows you to set a signal just like a constant combinator, but it only if I press I'm pressing F, it's just on for one tick. Also for normal combinators, it allows me to disable and enable them using F, which is very useful. Other mods, I have played with the recursive blueprints yet. I have recorded already a couple of episodes, but nothing yet with blueprints. With recursive blueprints, we have the disk mod, which we'll come to later. As already mentioned, we have Nixtitubes and the push button mod. Also have like Afraid of the Dark. Let's see. Nothing else, I believe. This is the disk mod, yeah. Okay, what do I mean if I say we will build a MIPS computer? So MIPS stands for microprocessor without interlocked pipeline stages. That's kind of a mouthful, but it just means it's a very simple, it's a very simple architecture. It has a very small instruction set, unlike x86, for example. All the instructions have the same size. Overall, it's pretty easy, and it's actually taught in universities for that reason. I learned it in my second semester. We will build 32-bit computer, and that's exactly what combinators support. Signed 32-bit integers. Let me go in map view, so you might already see a little bit. First, we will begin building the memory, and then this is the memory and the registers, and then we will, this is the CPU. We will start with the building the PC, the instruction decoding, ALU, the next PC environment, which is kind of a circuit that determines the next program counter. So normally that's just incremented, but if you do jumps or branches which are conditional jumps, they might change. So the next PC might be different. Also memory access, so you can read and write to memory. We'll all do that in a couple of episodes. I think the episodes will be between 30 and 1 hour long. They're pretty long. I recorded them in sets of 1 hour. This episode, where we will start, will be a little bit shorter because actually the first half, which I cut out, wasn't related to MIPS at all. And I know that in my recordings there's in the middle 1 hour where I actually work on nuclear and a little bit on power, because we might need to go nuclear soon, because when building this I actually had power issues. Yeah, that's the plan. So one thing to note is, even though I'm using mods for convenience, like displaying numbers and letters and having a push button, I can, this obviously, they are great blueprints for, and I even saw a great video about how to do a dot matrix display in Factorio. If I can find it, I will link it. So you can actually do those displays with a lot of lamps. So this is not strictly necessary. You don't have to use Nixie tubes. I highly recommend it though, because it makes debugging so much easier. The push button you also don't need. You can just use combinators, and with some circuitry you can even have also get a signal out that is just one pulse. So a pulse that's only one tick. Then I'm using the disk mod, which allows those disks. It's just a much easier way to get the programs into Factorio, although I have, and I'm still actually converting my programs to constant combinators. I have a script for that. I will someday I will share the code. It's not very clean. I will have to make a nice tool out of it, and then I would put it on GitHub. But this might take a while. The blueprint format isn't that hard, so you can write the tools yourself if you want. So you don't need disk either, strictly speaking. The CPU works in vanilla. I might even, once it's done, if it ever will be, I will maybe make a blueprint, compress it and make a blueprint of the CPU. Make some modular blueprints for the memory. Obviously I can't make a blueprint of the full memory, and I have some peripherals. You might see this is my screen and keyboard, so I will make a modular blueprint book, maybe even one that works without mods. Obviously the display uses Nixie tube, so I'm not gonna change that, but we could have the CPU just in vanilla. That's important. I will be looking at combinators a lot, right? So let's say I have a combinator times 2 will be C. This is alt mode on. I sometimes have it on, but it doesn't really help you that much, because you only see what kind of signal is going in, not what signal. So I will, for a lot of time, be sitting like that and looking at different combinators. What's important is I'm not just staring at the combinator. I'm looking over there on the right side of the screen, where I can see the input and output signals. Same for when I hover substations. They will show all the signals on red and green that are on them. So that's very important. Also, while I believe my style is pretty slow, I make a lot of pauses and need to think and need to look up stuff. I'm trying to cut it such that it's not that bad. But if it's too slow for you and the videos are too long, watch it at faster speed. I actually liked it more at faster speed when reviewing my footage. So you just put it on full speed. Otherwise it might be so slow that you can use it to help with sleep problems. Also, and then if I'm too fast sometimes, and I'm opening a combinator and you want to understand what's going on, just pause the video and look at what's connected. Maybe also pause the video and have a look at the connections. What is wired where? I'm trying to make it such that you can kind of see what's connected how. Sometimes it can get convoluted. Can imagine that. So, but pause the video whenever you need and speed it up if it's going too slow. Other than that, if you have any questions, if I should go into detail on any part of it, I'm happy to do so. So just leave a comment, and I will try to explain everything. So, also I noticed this might be a good point for all those computer science students. If you're doing like system architecture course, you might actually that might be you might watch this to prepare for for that class, because this is actually what we did in system architecture too, but then on a theoretical level and with proofs and stuff, to build a MIPS computer. But if you want to have something practical, build one in Factorio, where you can get. When I need to study for stuff, I often did practical approaches as well. Of course, I studied my course materials, but then I would write a program about it. Because when you actually use the stuff you are supposed to learn, at least for me, it's that I get a better intuition. My brain gets kind of gets hardwired on certain things, so I know that, for example, a negative 32-bit number has the most significant bit set. I can easily imagine binary signals, circuitry and stuff like that. You will get like intuition for that, how that behaves. So that might be a good thing just to get a practical view on this stuff. Of course, you can also build it in with electronics. There are super nice videos out there of people building 8-bit computers on breadboards. So yeah, just to get a feeling about how a computer works, this will be super useful. And in the meantime, you're watching someone play Factorio, but maybe you spend your time with that anyway sometimes. Well, I do, and so now you can combine it with you can tell your mom that you're studying for your system architecture course. I guess I will not hold this off any further, and I will hand it over to my past self. I guess I will start building here. So oh yeah, I don't have any robots on me. Oh, stacks has now 10? What was it all the time? And I want substations. Maybe let's set the request here to 5. But yeah, we're obviously not in the coverage. So we'll will this work? Anyway. Thing, well, I can just request it. Oh, I have requested clamps actually. Yes, we could need some. Okay. So we'll, how big is this? Okay. So let's just get some area covered here. Okay. Yeah, we'll just. Can we queue stuff? Apparently not. Okay, so I should have everything actually. It's a little bit some time ago that I built stuff. I remember that building this way is better because you can see the connections easier because they like hang down. If you do it like that, maybe I should activate. If you build like that, see, you can't tell. I can tell by hovering that this is not connected on the green wire, but it's very, very difficult. To see actually. I think I want a couple of buffer chests. So I'll just buffer those here so the bots can bring it to me very fast. I guess those should be higher. Push buttons as well. I guess substations. Okay, first thing we're gonna build is a memory cell. We'll have to things like that. This is gonna be. So let's say we have a X is the let's say X is what could be something. Yeah, let's say X is the internal value times or let's say 0 is one is the internal value, 2 is 1 if we are not writing to it. Three is If we're writing to it, this should output one. This should put output one. I believe this could be... Wait, 1 times the value we input. No, yeah, the value we input times write signal. Okay, to clarify that, maybe, so let's call it I, the input. This will be output as x, so x is the variable, the value of that cell, so I'm building a storage cell basically. I times, and w is the write signal, so x will be the input times. This is either 0 or 1. I believe we can just... This will be x. No. Okay. X times h, which is not writing, like hold the value, output x. Loop this back. They both need... No. They both output X, either one. And this also loops it back onto the input of that cell. So this needs input. Say that's 42. And we need the write or hold. We can just say that if write is greater than 0, do write. And if write is equal to 0, do hold. And this is not strictly necessary, because this will just, if that's 1, then we output 1, but it's just that it has the same delay. And I will hook those up here as well. So this has the stored value, right? So let's connect this, say x, and this will let's hook it up to here. Maybe we can make it a little bit nicer. So it's easier to see what connects to what. Okay, and then... Push buttons. No, I don't have push buttons. See, it's pretty fast because they're already there. This will be the write signal. Okay. That should not happen. Debug that. So this is H. And is this right? Yeah, see, this doesn't turn off. Oh yeah. See, we can now set any value, and once we hit that, it's in the cell. And it's also easy to have this resettable. For that, you would. Have this condition a little bit different, so basically a if W but not reset. So if you have reset, reset input, that this returns 0 and this also still 0, and that would delete the value. Okay, that's a basic memory cell. So maybe let's move that down here. So that's just to store one value. But if we need addressable stuff, it's a little bit more complicated. Let me remember. I think there are 3 inputs. This will be writing. And yeah, by the way, those internal signals, which I often use green cables, I will later rename them and use those as temporary values, because if I only use those for like internal values, I don't have that many conflicts. For example, this red wire must not have an I value. Must not have a W value. Well, it actually does have, right? So I guess, yeah. So I'm gonna do this right now. Rename them. So the green cable only has like 1 and 2 stuff. Still works, okay. So this is gonna detect. If that's the address. If W will be the right address, if that's the address of the cell, for the address of the cell, we will just have a constant combinator right now. Say it will be 512. And this will be on green. It doesn't matter. I don't think so. Okay, and this will be if that's unequal to A. So this basically gives us right or not right. This is right. Not right. So hold. Okay. So now the read is a little bit more complicated for each. Zero will exclude zero as valid address. Do each. So I could now say red 128. Oh no, if it's equal to A. So this will, if we give a signal with its address, it will output one on that. So then we take this thing. Except, yeah, we will use 3 here instead of x. One was override, right? So this will be 1, and this will be 2. Should change that. Let's maybe move them for now. And that value that's stored in the value 3 here, we'll take that and multiply that. We take each and multiply that with that value and output it as each. So hook that up. We also need this connection here. Yeah, I think this should be separate otherwise, because this leaks any input signal. Let's see what value is stored in there. Probably 0. So that's on 3 here. We have this. What we should be able to write a value. Where does the input go here? So that's the input, let's set that to 42. And we need the right bit. Oh no, it needs to be an address, right? Still, it should be. So if we set this to that address and pulse it, it stores it. No, it's gone. Okay, right. So if we make this a little bit clearer. Does it? I don't think that's necessary. Let's have a red one here, and this should also take input red. Why does it say one? Oh, okay, I get it. Because this is set to one. 1 second. Easy. So if red greater 0, input count on X. This was purple, so it's just basically renaming of the signal. So I can use X here as input. And don't use this color signal. This color signal is just to color the display. So now this should be outputting 42. Yeah, use arithmetic collimators. There we go. If I now also read on 512, so I can read on different signals at the same time, and can write values to it, and this address. Will be chained. So that's the memory. That's one word of it. So 32 bits. So we need 1,000 for 4 kilobytes of memory. And we need at least 12 kilobytes, so 4 kilobytes for code, 4 for data, and 4 for stack. Yeah. So, oh, we should research. I will start building the memory then in the next episode. Bye.